Welcome to the sixth video in the Essential Extract Vector Calculus series. In this video, we're going to talk about the fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals. First, we'll talk about the statement and proof of the fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals, and then we'll have a brief discussion about conservativity and its relationship to independence of path. If you're following along with the summary of vector calculus handout, a link to which is available in the video description, what we're going to be covering in this video is the first of the four fundamental theorems at the bottom of the sheet. The next two fundamental theorems, Green's theorem and Stokes' theorem, will be covered in the next video, and the divergence theorem will be covered in video 8. Let's take a look at the statement of the fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals. What it says is that the line integral of the third kind of the gradient of a scalar field over a piecewise smooth curve C is equal to the difference of the values of the scalar field at the endpoints of the curve. As I've indicated here, the scalar field is a function from Rn to R. You do need to assume that the first partial derivatives of the scalar field exist and are continuous. The piecewise smooth curve C is given by the parametrization R of t equals x1 of t to xn of t, with t going from A to B. You should notice a strong similarity between this and the statement of the usual fundamental theorem of calculus. On the left-hand side, the integrand involves the derivatives of the scalar field, and the right-hand side involves the values of the scalar field at the endpoints of integration. The scalar field here is playing the role of the antiderivative in the usual fundamental theorem of calculus. In order to see this connection more clearly, let's take a look at the proof of the fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals. As mentioned, the object on the left-hand side is an example of the third kind of line integral that we talked about in video 4. One of the computations that we did in video 4 shows that this line integral is equal to the integral from A to B, the partial of f with respect to x1, times the derivative of x1 with respect to t, plus dot 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 partial of f with respect to xn, derivative of xn with respect to t, dt. Remember that f is a function of the variables x1 to xn, and that each one of the variables x1 to xn is a function of t. Therefore, if you remember the chain rule from multivariable calculus, you'll recognize immediately that the quantity in parentheses here is the derivative with respect to t of the function f of r of t. Now, the integrand is just a regular function of t. And from the usual fundamental theorem of calculus, we recognize right away that the integral is equal to the value of f at the right endpoint, r of b, minus the value of f at the left endpoint. That concludes the proof of the fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals. And you can see that after some manipulation involving definitions and the chain rule, it indeed did follow from the regular fundamental theorem of calculus. One important consequence of the fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals is that line integrals of conservative vector fields are always independent of path. In order to help you understand what this statement means, first let me remind you of the definition of what it means for a vector field to be conservative. A vector field capital F on an open subset D of Rn is called conservative if and only if capital F is the gradient of a scalar field from D to R. This is the definition of conservativity of vector fields, which was given in video 2. To say that the line integral of a vector field is independent of path means that for any two piecewise smooth curves, C1 and C2, connecting the endpoints, the integral of f dot dr over C1 is equal to the integral of f dot dr over C2. The fundamental theorem of calculus for line integrals tells us that if capital F is the gradient of a scalar field little f, then the values of both of these integrals only depend on the endpoints. That's the explanation for the statement at the top of this slide. Anytime we have a conservative vector field capital F on an open region D and Rn, we know that line integrals over piecewise smooth curves contained in the region D only depend on the endpoints of the curves. That is, they're path independent. As a real-world application, let's return to the gravitational force example that we saw in video 2. This is an example in three dimensions, which models the gravitational force exerted by an object of mass capital M sitting at the origin on an object of mass little m sitting at a point x in space. You can look back at video number 2 if you want to see the details of how we derive this. Let's suppose we want to calculate the work done by this force in moving the object of mass little m from a point A to a point B in three-dimensional space. If we want to do this directly using the work integral, then we need to parametrize the curve and use the definition of the line integral of the third kind. However, we could also notice, as derived in the second video, that the gravitational field is a conservative force. It's the gradient of the scalar field from R3 to R, defined by little m big M g divided by the square root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared. The significance of this observation is that the work done by the gravitational force in moving an object from A to B doesn't depend on the path taken. We can evaluate the work integral just by evaluating this scalar field at the endpoint and subtracting. You might have already learned something like this in physics, but here's the mathematical justification for that fact. Finally, I'd like to talk a little bit more about the relationship between conservativity and path independence. We already said that if a vector field F is conservative on an open region D of Rn, then line integrals of the vector field over piecewise smooth curves contained in the region are path independent. After seeing a lot of examples, we might also wonder whether or not there's a converse of this statement. If we have a vector field F with the property that line integrals of the vector field are path independent, does it imply that the vector field is conservative? It turns out that there is such a converse. As long as D is an open and connected region of Rn, and the vector field F is continuous, it's not too difficult to show that F is conservative if and only if line integrals of F are path independent. This shows that under mild hypotheses, conservativity is equivalent to path independence. If we're working in three dimensions, then we can take this discussion one step further. Remember that in the second video, we said that if we're working in three dimensions and the region D is open and simply connected, and if the first partials of F exist and are continuous, then F being conservative is equivalent to F being irrotational. Irrotational, remember, means that the curl of F is zero. Combining this observation with our characterization of conservativity in terms of path independence, we see that under these hypotheses, conservativity, path independence, and being irrotational are all equivalent properties. For convenience, this discussion is summarized in the vector calculus handout near the top right in the section that looks like this. Well, that's the end of this video. Thank you for watching. There are only two videos remaining in this series, and in the next video, we're going to talk about Green's and Stokes' theorems.